This program is brought to you by the Merdeka Award, an initiative to promote excellence by ExxonMobil, Petronas and Shell.
I'm Cynthia Ng, and this is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. For this episode, we would like to talk about the future of our past. Now, the past I'm referring to is Malaysia's history and heritage legacy. Now, we Malaysians, we are blessed with rich cultural heritage. Nevertheless, the protection and conservation of these places in many parts of the country continue to be confronted with increasing challenges as a result of rapid population growth. Also, we talk about development pressures. So for this episode, we want to talk about how do we secure a balance between development and preservation. Also, we would like to talk about how can we use our past and our heritage to create a shape, a better and sustainable future for Malaysia. Now, I'm joined by a distinguished panel of experts today. First and foremost, I'd like to introduce on my far left, we have Datuk Haji Hajeedar Abdul Majid. He is the chairman of ICOMOS Malaysia, the International Council on Monuments and Sites. He is also the chairman of Majlis Warisan Kebangsaan, and Datuk, of course, has pioneered many conservation and rehabilitation efforts of many historic buildings in Malaysia. Now, next to me, I'm joined by Ms. Elizabeth Cardosa. She's the president of Badan, Warisan Malaysia, an NGO dedicated towards the conservation of Malaysia's heritage build. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Now, next to me, I have none other than Sir Hijjas Kasturi, well considered as the father of Malaysian architecture, the person behind Kuala Lumpur's some of KL's most prominent buildings. We can talk about Maybank Tower, Tabung Haji. He's also the principal and director at Hijjas Kasturi Associates. And next, we have Ms. Lillian joining us. She is the senior principal at VERITAS Design Group, also council member of Badan Warisan Malaysia, and a strong advocate for conservation of urban architectural heritage. Thank you so much, Lillian, for joining. And last but not least, we have another very influential architect with us today, Professor Dr. Jimmy Lim of Jimmy Lim Design. Among other many accolades, he was also the recipient of the prestigious Aga Khan Award for Architectural Excellence. Thank you so much, ladies, gentlemen, for coming on the show. Now, we have a very important topic to talk about, perhaps not talk about as much as it should, which is heritage conservation. Now, let's get the ball rolling and start by getting your views on the state of conservation efforts in Malaysia. What is a Malaysian experience, and do you think we have done enough to preserve our heritage? I'd like to start with Datuk.
Preservation and conservation is something that is very important to the sustenance of our not only culture, but well-being as a normal citizen. So it poses as a not only a challenge, but a dilemma. Because we have the various pressures equally dynamic in trying to demonstrate our economic activity and progress. But at the same time, we must not forget the fact that we are not where we are today without our past. It is the past that establishes our present situation. And if we understood the present in the context of the past, then we will be able to plan and project our future into a much more meaningful identity and well-being. So I think for a start, that is the state of the heritage and conservation in this country. Notwithstanding, there have been a series of laws and regulations that has been passed through Parliament, and that ultimately the most current and most comprehensive act is the Heritage Act of 2005, and in which there is a definite effort at trying to conserve both the assets of our tangible heritage as well as the intangible heritage in the country. Because if you look at the country itself, we are hardly 60 years old. And there have been other countries that are much older than us and they have been not only struggling to conserve their heritage, but also faced similar challenges. And fortunately, the UNESCO has initiated the recognition of various sites, as well as architectural edifices that will represent the heritage of the world. In the year 2000, we had two natural sites that has been declared as World Heritage Site. One is the Kinabalu Park, and the other is the Mulu Cave in Sarawak. Then subsequently, we were fortunate to have the only twin city declaration as a World Heritage Site in the form of Georgetown and Malacca. And the latest is that we've got Lenggong. Lenggong is an archaeological site that establishes the earliest human settlement in this part of the world. And I think subsequently, in time to come, I think there is reference and mention made to Lembah Bujang, for example. Mm-hmm. Lembah Bujang is a real classic study that has to be done very thoroughly before we can get its accreditation as a World Heritage Site. Because there is a possibility that the scientific evaluation will declare the Lembah Bujang or Bujang Valley as a civilization that is even older than Borobudur and Angkor Wat.
Okay.
So in terms of the context of Malaysia with regard to heritage and conservation, I think we are in a very prominent as well as important position so as not to abuse or destroy this potential.
So we have set the parameters, we have the policies, we have the guidelines. Have we done enough, sir?
Obviously, it's not enough. You know, what is enough? As has been said before, even the older generations or the older countries find it very difficult to do it, let alone Malaysia, which is only getting independent 60 years ago, and it's considered as a very young country. So we got to learn from the past. Of course, there are many examples in the past that you can follow. For example, in Italy, the whole area is conservation area. You cannot do anything new, for example. That's its national kind of preservation control that you have. And perhaps you should have like that. And there are many examples of various kinds. But what is important is implementation. The lack of it, we have neglected for so long. And we've been pursuing nothing else but financing our countries all the time. Money is the most important thing all the time, and neglecting our own culture, for that matter. The culture in this sense, not only heritage, building heritage, historical heritage, but arts as well, in every form of arts. We have, in many ways, neglected that. And yet we are so rich in diversity, in different of cultures that we have. It's like our neighbors, for example. They neglected too long. They're very successful, you know, economically and financially and so on, but they are void in terms of culture. And now they're beginning to buy this culture because they don't foster that in itself. They don't preserve it.
All right.
Now, that I can talk later.
Perhaps the issue here is recognizing that importance in the bigger context of nation building, and how does heritage play, in fact, a much bigger role in not only preserving our heritage, but also setting the direction for the future generation. Now, thank you so much for setting the context in this first block. I'll have to take this conversation to the first commercial break, but we'll be back shortly for more. Stay with us, and this is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. Welcome back to the Merdeka Award Roundtable. Our topic for today is preservation of our historical and heritage legacy. Now, earlier we talked about recognizing the importance of heritage in nation building. I'd like to get straight to Professor Jimmy, your views about, are there lack of recognition towards the role that heritage plays towards shaping Malaysia?
Well, I don't think there is no recognition. I think there is wide appreciation among the public. Mm-hmm. People are quite happy and quite proud of what we have. I mean, you just have to take Taiping, for example. Every weekend, Taiping is full of people visiting Taiping for its natural beauty, the lakes, the trees, those huge rain trees that goes over the road around the Tasik that touches the water on the other side, Maxwell Hill in the background, and all the quaint little shop houses and the rest houses in Taiping. All these are people recognizing what Taiping has. People instinctively understand our culture, instinctively love what we have. You know, on the first day of Hari Raya, you know, all the families were there decked up in the most colorful, taking pictures, but so beautiful. You know, when you see this happening, you say, hey, wonderful. You know, we have wonderful things. Yeah? That's on the upside. Yeah, conservation in Malaysia is recognition. It's like love-hate relationship.
How so? Can you elaborate? Because first of all, I mean, to preserve heritage, we need to recognize and also to perhaps also document and then yes. We can start to implement the works.
Well, the love for heritage, history, our forests, our rivers, our seas are actually among the people, the rakyat. Penang is losing its iconic heritage coastline, the Gurney Drive, where all the rituals, all the poems about Nyonya Baba culture, about Chap Goh Meh, throwing oranges, throwing little drums, all these were things that happened at Gurney Drive. The dragon boat races, long Gurney Drive.
I'm going to offer a contrarian view in the sense that when we talk about conservation, heritage, Malaysians tend to look at Malacca as well as Penang as perhaps one of the best in terms of conservation. Now, perhaps, Liz, do you have a different opinion from Professor? Do you feel that perhaps in the midst of developing a nation, a state, an island, we have lost touch on what's important for our heritage?
I think that when we look at heritage, I think we need to start sort of understanding at what level you're talking about, because there are a lot of laws that look at, for example, the national heritage level. So they're very high, you know, highly elevated culture, which is something that everybody shares, that are iconic buildings for the country. But at local levels, I think what Jimmy was talking about, in Taiping, for example, you know, at a very much more modest level. So it depends on where you pack it, but I think where you place it. But I think that part of the problem is the commodification of culture and the commodification of heritage, where it becomes a commodity for tourism only. You know, if heritage has its intrinsic value, its intrinsic value is to the community who right. own it. And if you take it and you say, okay, right, fine, let's pick this part out because tourists will be interested, well, all well and good. But if you only promote it because of tourism, not because it belongs to a group of people, not because it's part of the cultural identity of the place, then you start breaking it up, I think.
Well, I think there is increasingly in the last few years, especially since the listing of Malacca and Penang in 2008.
That's right.
There has been a lot of increase in interest, especially among young people, which previously there was a lot of it lacking. But I think what's needed really is increased commitment, as Hijjas had mentioned earlier, increased commitment to conserve, increased understanding. Of course, education, I think, is ongoing. I think young people today have a lot of exposure through social media. They know quite a bit. But perhaps they are not sort of, you know, the armature is not there to harness the energy to make it an influential movement. So we are reliant a lot on the government as the guardian in trust for the community, because, you know, a heritage property can be all individually owned. Many of them are individually owned. Of course, the ones which are owned by the government are already protected. They're all gazetted. They're the 50 buildings that are in the National Heritage Register. What's endangered are the individual private ones, because they all would be subject to development pressure. And one must remember that an individual also has enshrined rights to property. This is enshrined in the Federal Constitution, Article 13, right? So you can't really expect the individual to be contributing the enjoyment of his property. It is for the larger community and large, and that's the reason why the role of government is very important. They must step in with higher commitment, higher allocation in the Malaysia plan than we have seen so far today, to be able to commit money and set examples, do precedent projects, to take a lead, to be an example, to conserve buildings, and not just buildings, entire districts or neighbourhoods.
Yeah. There's plenty of things. We got to put our heads down and find a solution. You know, what is a win-win solution? You know, you can't take property from stakeholders, you know, and say, should be conserved. You can't do that, because he lost all his opportunity to build.
So what's the best way to do this?
The best way is we got to find ways and means to fund it. And there are many ways how to do it. You have what we call tax credit. You give him the tax credit, and that somebody else can buy that tax credit, and you can conserve that buildings, for example. This is just like
Transport development rights.
So, or you do something else, but you must do it quickly. Otherwise, they raise it to fire one day, and that's lost everything. Once you identify it, grab it, and then just give that incentive. And all the business people can come up, okay, I'll buy the tax credit for that. I get plot ratio, either in terms of plot ratio, right. I get bigger, or I give you money that will be deducted from my tax income. And that's how you can get fun.
This is one issue, tax deduction. I'll tell you the story. We have worked on this for the last, I think, 4 years in trying to convince the government to give deduction for identified historic buildings so that the stakeholders could preserve them and all that. But of course, it comes under the ambit of the Ministry of Finance, and it is revenue to them. They are not prepared to do that. So it's a losing battle trying to convince them. But at the same time, you have to pursue this, because we have seen, not very far, in our neighboring countries, that the exemption and the tax benefit is not only here in Malaysia, you get about 7%. If you spend money on conservation, you get about 7% tax deduction. But in another country, which is not so far away, it's 200%, because they value that culture. And I think Hijjas has already made mention of that. They are trying to build up their cultural base, whereas we are ignoring our cultural base. So this is why I say we are in a dilemma. You know, we want to preserve our culture, but the incentives are not there. So it makes it quite difficult. You have to really convince them. You look at KL, for example. We've lost a few of the more notable mentions.
Can you give us some examples? What are those mentions?
Bok House, Chua Cheng Bok House. I mean, it has been brought down very quickly, and we can see what's going up there. It's yet another.
Perhaps Pudu Jail is also one.
Pudu Jail is another example. You see, we tend to forget. We need the jails to remind us of some other cultural aspect or lifestyle. Apart from that. Yeah. Right. But don't forget, these are all relevant institutions to form a government. Mm-hmm. Jails are meant for people who have broached the law.
Elizabeth, I know you have your thoughts.
I was just going,
but I'll have to take this second commercial break, but I will get back to you very shortly. Don't go away. This is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. Yeah. Welcome back. This is the Merdeka Award Roundtable, and we're talking about the preservation of Malaysia's heritage legacy. Let's talk about the value of preservation. I'd like to get first to Jimmy. We talked about how different people, different stakeholders has a role to play, but you mentioned private sector is crucial when it comes to kickstarting that funding and also the initiative at the ground level.
Well, I think, both Hajeedar and Hijjas have mentioned about government participation. But then I think in certain instances, government participation, financial, is not really required. You just take the case in point of Penang. Prior to Penang getting the UNESCO World Heritage Site status, the value of property in Georgetown was zilt because the lifting of the Rent Control Act caused a lot of people moving out of Georgetown. Because prior to that, they could rent a shop house in Sintra Street, Kimberley Street, for 80 ringgit a month. Then these people sublet it, the rooms to different people at $120. So at the end of the day, what he rents for 80 ringgit, he rents out at 400, so he pockets 320. So once the Rent Control Act was lifted, prices went up. They all shifted back to the apartments they bought up in Far Lim Estate, the Paya Trebong, whatever it is. So Georgetown became literally a ghost town. You could get pick up those units for 150,000 each shop lots. Today, these similar shop lots are into millions, from 1.5 million up to 2.3, 3.2 million, right, depending on their length. So you see, with that UNESCO status coming into Georgetown, a lot of people started to come in to invest. And he just is one of them, you know, he's mm-hmm. come in and contributed tremendously to uplifting one part of Georgetown, which at a certain period of time was really low, but now it's really every opposite his development, Singaporeans bought up that whole row, and then they bought it up. So Singaporeans are buying because they see this as great value.
I would want to interject here, because what then happens is that while neighborhoods then change the character of the neighborhoods, good on the one hand, because you are talking about the preservation of the built environment,
you start losing, not physically change.
I'm not talking about physical
in terms
change.
Of community.
I'm talking about
you see,
community.
Prior to the lifting of the Rent Control Act, Penang, Georgetown consisted of a lot of little urban villages. Yes. I call them urban villages. That's why, if you look at Georgetown, you've got the Buckingham Street Market, you've got Charasta Market, you've got the Siaboy Market, then you've got the market King Street. You see all this, and then the market. So all these markets are within 1 kilometer, 1.5 kilometer. It suggests huge population. But by the time 2007 was on, Georgetown was a dead place. I know that because my family have properties there. And around us were nothing. When I was a child growing up in Sintra Street, Campbell Street, those streets were bustling with people. I can show you photographs, black and white pictures taken in the 50s, 60s. Campbell Street, full of people. Penang Road, full of people. At that time, there was. But now, with this reintroduction of heritage thing, it's created new life. Now, gentrification may be considered bad, but what it has created is a culture among the younger people. And this, to me, is a very encouraging sign. A lot of people, younger people, are now visiting these places, finding out what it is about and all. And this enthusiasm for Penang has not only just stuck on Penang, it spread on to Ipoh. Ipoh has become a real stopover for part of this heritage trail today, you know. I mean, 2 weeks ago, I visited Ipoh, and I was surprised. The number of young people there just staying for the weekend. Where are you from? KL. Where are you coming? Oh, just to check this place up. You know, and I think this is one of the good things. So maybe in this respect, our young people are beginning to appreciate more of our own thing. And I think the stakeholding of preserving our heritage is now being transferred to our younger generation. And that spells a lot of encouragement.
Looking back 40 years ago, 50 years ago, and moving forward, where do you see we have the most opportunity when it comes to preserving our heritage?
I think my success is that whatever I can do, the little that I can do, I do it. And that's to reflect that. I always believe in our own identity. What is a nation without its own identity? Where does it come from? As an architect, you want to identify that. If I'm a composer of music, I want to reflect Malaysian music. Mm-hmm. If I'm a chef, I want to reflect Malaysian food. You know, this is the way that you are, a kind of nation building that's imbued in me because I was part of this pro-independence before. You know, this is part of that. So you can only do it by example. And I think one of example that people cherish very much is that I have opportunity to rebuild terrace houses, shop houses in Penang into something. Mm-hmm. And that has been very successful. And the success is not only just to preserve it, but you have to enhance it. You have to make it that it is, not only life, put up life, but something's new for the new generation. The new generation doesn't want to go backwards so much, you know. You want to see what else you added. In other words, it's evolution of that. So if you go to this hotel that I do, which is very unique, you find something else inside that. It is modern inside, but outside you preserve 100%. And that also goes with my buildings, that you see all my buildings. It reflects something of our culture and so on. And today, you know, I used to do all this multi-story building. Now I come back to do small building. And now I'm involved with small resort hotel in Chengdu. And it's exciting, it's because I'm relearning it, the whole of our philosophy, and also the whole handicraft of Malaysian handicraft, and how to bring this thing into your new architecture. And to me, it's exciting. It is exciting in a way, not just to follow from before, but to produce it in a new way. In other words, so that the young people can accept it. No. The young people cannot accept old language, you know. Munshi Abdullah language, they can't understand that. The old people cannot appreciate terang bulan. So you got to go that evolution I'm talking about, so that the young people say, yes, this is good.
But for now, we'll have to go for the next commercial break. Do stay with us. This is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. Welcome back. This is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. Our topic for today is preserving Malaysia's heritage legacy. Now, I'd like to get straight to Datuk Hajeedar and talk about some of the most successful heritage conservation. You have undertaken quite a bit, but let's talk about what can we learn from it and looking at the past and how we have what we have done and looking then at the future on what more can be done. Yep. Let's talk about some of those places yep. that you have done.
Okay. Way back in 1970s, when I first came back to the country after being away in England for about 7 years, then I saw the threat on some of our historic buildings, especially these colonial buildings that we inherited from the British, and that they were neglected, and I felt that something must be done before we lose them. So through the Majalah Architect, I wrote a two-part article. The first is to argue for the need to conserve our heritage, and the second was to identify areas where they can be declared mm-hmm. heritage areas and our historic core of the city of Kuala Lumpur, where the British administrators were. Then through that effort, of course, the article got some coverage. The media picks it up. Then through the late Tan Sri Harun Hashim, who was then the president of the Industrial Court, who called me to ask me whether I was the guy who wrote such an article and challenged me to put my money where my mouth is. and that was his exact term. And he showed me this building, which was then used as a storage space for the post office for confiscated documents in the post. And it was available. And he wanted to move his industrial court from Jalan Duta to that building and challenged me to create his courts there. So I managed to create 6 courts for him, and it has been there until recently, for all these years, since 1984, I believe. Yeah.
Datuk, what is your biggest challenge when it comes to conserving heritage buildings?
It's to convince the stakeholders, i.e. the government. The JKR was the owner of those buildings. So I have to convince them, because at that point in time, the notion was that to do adaptive reuse and conservation is very costly. Mm-hmm. They cannot see the benefit of spending the money and seeing the product. Whereas we were looking at it from the sustaining of the historic contents and the value of that in the context of our heritage. So I wanted such buildings to represent the milestone of our progress. You know, we were once colonized by the Portuguese, then the Dutch, then the British, and it was the British that left more heritage within our environment than the other colonialists. So the stock of buildings that the British built were a lot. So subsequently, after the first adaptive reuse that I've done, and in fact, that building was not even a government building, it was the Chow Kit department store. It belongs to Lok Chow Kit. It was
it
a department store.
To Lok
Yew, of course.
You actually rented it out to Chow Kit.
Chow Kit, and it was called Chow Kit department store. So, and then subsequently, the then Prime Minister was impressed with the work done, and he says, the Minister of Work says that it's very expensive to do. How much did it cost you? So it was less than $1 million to do that. And he said, that's cheap. And we've got a new industrial court there.
Right.
So after which, he was convinced that adaptive reuse of our colonial building is better than to destroy and wipe out our heritage and legacy. We have to look at it as a legacy. You can't rebuild that building again. You know, so it has to be sustained.
Okay.
So this is where the subsequent restoration came about for Sultan Abu Samad building, was turned to a court by BEP architect, and I did the others to the Infocraft, the Jabatan Warisan, Jabatan Agama Islam, as well as the KL Gallery now. And which, as we went along, we whet the appetite of the people and say, look, there is in need for conservation.
Right.
And hence, it climaxed with the adaptive reuse of the Kakosa Srinagara.
Around that period, strangely, when you look at, reflect back in history, seems to be a time when there was a very conscious awareness among professionals as well as government officials, you know, towards our heritage. There was a certain sense of pride. And this was that period when I mentioned that whenever we are in an architectural conference, we always say, what's the Malaysian identity? When a building is built, I say, what's the Malaysian identity? That's on everybody's mm-hmm. lip, every minister, you know. They used to say, what's the Malaysian identity? So during that period, that's about the period that Badan Warisan was formed. I was one of the 4 founders of Badan. You know, the other 3 have gone to the other side of the world. Badan started very modestly. The person that was really pushing very much was the late Tan Sri Mubin Shepherd. The first thing he said, we must reserve a building in Klang. So we all went down there to have a look, and there was this half broken down,
it was just a go-down,
yeah,
like modest-looking go-down.
No, no, yeah, it was. But then at that time, it belonged to the police.
Yes.
And the police were going to knock it down to build 2 badminton courts. So he had to go and see the Sultan to stop this action. So, and then the museum at the time was under Dato Sharum.
Sharum Yop.
And Mubin went there and said, please send some of your first go and tidy up the place. So that at our next visit, the whole Gedung was painted green in color. Horrified. So, but never mind. So anyway, the thing was preserved with some funding and what have you.
And what are some of the setbacks that you faced?
The setbacks?
Yes.
At that time, well, true setbacks, no. The whole euphoria and enthusiasm in Badan that we are new movement, want to preserve our heritage and that sort of thing, you know? And I think one of the things we tried to save was the courthouse at Bukit Mahkamah, you know, before it was torn down. Remember that? Yeah, there was one, but it was demolished, and then, you know, he just built his very iconic building. But then, you see, I mean...
So I was born there. on that hill.
Yeah. The Maybank Tower we're talking about.
But some part of it I preserved.
No, you didn't.
No, the garden is preserved. The garden is preserved.
So, you know, from there on, then, after that Gedung was done up, opened as a tin museum, you know, it was very successful. Okay. Lots of people in Klang went there. Then that also prompted the Klang local authorities to convert the old police contingent building back into a part of their local majlis, you know, Dara.
All right.
So from there, then the next major project, which Badan Warisan did, was to preserve the old Tunku Istana Long, you know.
In
Besut. In Besut, Terengganu. So Petronas gave some funds. So Raja Bahrain went there to have this whole thing taken down, removed, re-erected, and it's still there today.
Okay.
So these were the two major successes. Then, of course, the next one is a commercial one, which was the Central Market. So during that whole period, you know, there was this great euphoria about our heritage. But then somehow since then, I don't know. Actually, KL's preservation towards our conservation, I think, heightened under the watch of our Tan Sri Elias Omar, who was the Datuk Bandar. Under his charge, a lot of areas were discussed for preservation and all that. And he planted a lot of trees all across KL. But the moment he stepped down, a lot of these things were undone.
Okay.
And I think since then, conservation in KL is a topic that not many people talk about. We lost the Bok House, you know, and all this.
Yeah, we lost the Bok House because it's privately owned.
Yeah, la.
So
but
there
then,
is
you
no
know,
obligation on legal obligation. This is why subsequently, now we've got the Heritage Act that helps interpret the need to preserve.
Mm.
But all is not lost because the Dewan Tengku Abdurrahman, which is the Saloma today,
yes,
was our first parliament for example.
Yeah.
And that was donated by the Yu family. And say the same thing with our Istana Negara, the first Istana Negara. And likewise, there are some very handsome old building that has been preserved thanks to the benevolence of the individuals.
Okay.
But notwithstanding that, after the initial work in conservation, City Hall incorporated a section in the structure plan on conservation. And that's the beginning of it. Because then we had only the Antiquity Act that looks after archaeological sites
monuments,
and monuments
right,
and
monuments.
Things. Nothing on buildings. Whereas the present, what do you call, Akta Warisan, provides for a much more comprehensive. And then through this majlis that I chair, we have now 13 subcommittees to look at all aspects of our warisan, from language to literature to dancing to
tangible
song.
And the intangible.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's to me is progress. But notwithstanding, in spite of the progress, I've often given the analogy of trying to carry water with your hands. You know, as you carry it, you can.
A lot of
it.
Yeah. Okay. We have to go for the last commercial break, but when we come back, let's talk about the way forward and how do you envision Malaysia in terms of our conserving our heritage, say maybe 10, 20 years from now. Let's get to that after the break.
Certainly.
We'll see you in a bit. Stay with us. Now, conservation is not only crucial for national development, but it's also important for us to develop the pride in heritage and also, more importantly, for the future generation. So now with this last segment, I want to get your thoughts about how do you envision the preservation and conservation of heritage in Malaysia, say, 10, 20 years from now?
Okay, well, I think that with the increasing awareness and appreciation, there's a lot I think we can do to, as I mentioned earlier, to harness the young people's commitment to it, and commitment also from our local authorities, the government. Mm. Actually, an architect's role is very challenging because we have to facilitate and mediate between parties with conflicting interests often. In you know, because a lot of heritage projects inevitably tend to be located in areas of very high estate
value.
Yeah. So I think as an architect, it's quite important, I think, to be able to have all parties know what's at stake and to facilitate as much as possible. In this note, I would like to, for instance, refer about Bok House. You know, we actually are the architects doing the new building on the Bok House. But of course, our client is two generations later. But one of the things that perhaps was not known is that the Bok House suffered a land acquisition that made it unable to develop its property in that state. Because earlier, you know, the grounds was very large. But when a lot of it was acquired by compulsory acquisition, all they had left was the house sitting very tightly in the site. So again, as mentioned, it's an individual property. They had no choice. They couldn't develop, transfer development rights, you know, it was too early days perhaps, or the parties were not there to facilitate, to enable buildings to such as that, which is just unfortunate, it's lost. But I think, I hope we have more integration of all the various enabling authorities, architects included, consultants, NGOs.
Environmentalists.
So that we together have to find the solution, because the solution will not rest in the individual's
benevolence. It's multidimensional. You have different stakeholders and different levels.
Yes, all right, we can't expect an individual to save it, but we all have to work together to enable it.
Perhaps, Professor, your views about your wish for conservation.
Well, one thing we must remember, conservation, preservation is not about brick and mortar. It is about communities. You can have all the buildings around you, there's no culture, there's no heritage. That's number one. Number two, I think there's a big groundswell of what conservation is about, and I like to go back to use Penang as an example, where the people, the community themselves has taken an active part in participating in the gentrification and the maintaining of the perceived what they like to see in Penang. And one of my greatest wish for KL, it sounds a bit strange, you know, I've always been a great proponent for our Malaysian tropical architecture using timber, the kampong traditions, the way of life and what have you. Actually, it's always been my unsaid dream that Kampung Baru should be preserved as a whole entity of what to showcase what the Malaysian, Malay village life and culture can be right in the heart of a great metropolitan city. That's my greatest dream.
All right, let's get to the KL city boy, Datuk Hajeedar.
Sorry.
He mentioned about his wish list for Kuala Lumpur
to the preservation. Yeah, I mean, Jimmy's view about Kampung Baru. But notwithstanding, we have all the necessary legislations and laws, and then we have all the enlightened individuals, as well as some less enlightened individuals who are in position to make decisions. So we have to start thinking out of the box and start looking at other ways of solving problems. Maybe a lot of people don't understand and don't remember or don't even know the fact that the PEM building in Jalan Tan Sri was safe and preserved because we were able to convince the land owners then, which was the property owner. No, the property Saikachi. Owner was Sai Kachi and Datuk Chong Kok Lin, to allow that building to remain and that we transfer the development potential of that elsewhere. And that was transferred to the Selayang market. You know? So this is the kind of thing that you have to look at the problem without really getting so emotional, but be rational about it and try and convince each other about the need for that. And then on our part, you know, taking that little responsibility of chairing the Majlis Warisan, the challenge is to make it attainable. You know, it's not just chakap, but implement it and get everybody together towards this common objective of sustaining our heritage. Because we only have one lifetime to do that. And I am sort of appealing through this program to say, let's do something about your heritage, because you have only one last opportunity. And at a recent seminar, we talked about how do we create awareness of our heritage. One is through education. Then we also discover that we need re-education. The reason being, when they were kids and they were younger and they were at university before they graduated, they were educated and aware of and sensitive to cultural awareness and values and tradition and things like that. But once they get into office, they tend to lose that
sight.
And they are insensitive to all this. Okay. And inevitably, you get destructions done as recently as what has happened with regard to the Twin Peak or the Puncak Purnama, a sculpture done by our laureate and Syed Ahmad Jamal, and then donated to the city, and it was just wiped out overnight. So this is the kind of insensitivity that happens and evokes this kind of emotion and sentiment that the public has. Public has no channel to express themselves apart from demonstrations and seminars or perhaps talks and workshops. But that's about all we can do. But why do we need to go that way when we could have anticipated all this through through administration and through sensitivity of people's culture? You know, you may not be born in KL, but you are holding a substantial office and authority in KL. Of course, to a person like me from KL, I'm very sensitive to that, just like Jimmy is to Penang, you know, like everyone else to wherever they come from, you know,
Elizabeth.
Singapore.
I think I would say it really then boils down to this process of engagement with community and an openness to a consultative process. Because I think that that part of the problem is it's, you know, if I am the ultimate authority that makes the decision, how much do you really want to consult others in that process? And I think that while the laws and a lot of guidelines do promote this engagement, you know, focus group discussions, etc., it's how do you take it really and embrace it?
Okay.
How do you actually really, really make it real as part of this process of because it's not just about the big, the beautiful, the beauty queen. It is about the modest. It is about what we came from. We were a very modest society. We're now kind of a bit like, you know, so it's not just about, you know, keeping only what is grand, but keeping what is important for communities and at many different levels. So it is about, you know, approaching these levels and engaging with them. from all levels.
Last but not least, let's get your thoughts, Sir Hijjas Kasturi, given what you have been instrumental in the architectural scene in Malaysia, and looking forward, what do you wish for?
The way forward, is, as I can see it, is to form a strategy so that we can have many pronged attacks how to get this thing done. Of course, one is to have legislation. You know, if you have legislation from UNESCO, for example, that's done with, nobody can change that. But in town planning, you can do that. But that's only one aspect. You've got to go to the media to make it popular about heritage, conservation, civilization, or whatever, arts and so on. So you make it popular so that it's palatable to the young people. So you've got to be many directions, and the places that you have is exposed to them, not only exposed to our people here, but to the whole nation, so that the visitors from outside will come here to look at it. Where is this? You know, there are some heritage that form new one, like the Twin Towers. That's our new heritage. And not only old one, but we can also doing new heritage. And that's what we should do, to mix the whole blend of it. And therefore, we can make a greater Malaysia.
Thank you so much. No better way to wrap that up. Thank you to our panelists again for your wonderful insights. And also, I'd like to say a big thank you to the Akil Convention Center for hosting the 15th Merdeka Award Roundtable. Do check out our Facebook to find out more about the Merdeka Award. Also, you can check out www.merdekaaward.my for more information. Once again, I'm Cynthia Ng. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you soon.
This program was brought to you by the Merdeka Award, an initiative to promote excellence by ExxonMobil, Petronas, and Shell.